This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The doctor is in with me, Dr. D. Archer. Thank you for joining us for another exciting show on a Tuesday evening. You know, we talk all things health, wellness, and things that pertain to the Bahamian society. So I want you to thank you for taking out the time to be in with us tonight. We're hoping that this is going to be really, really informative and just, you know, an interesting show. Tonight's show, of course, brought to you by Medical Concierge Services for all your healthcare needs, primary care needs. If you need to sign up for NHI or for with us, then you can check us out at 326-1521 or WhatsApp us 429-4880. You can find us on Facebook, Instagram, and of course, our website, medicalconciergeservices.com or mcsfamilymedicine.com. All right. Interesting topic tonight. I didn't realize it would be so controversial, but I even got myself a little bit in trouble online talking with some other doctors who were actually talking about the subject and letting them know that I was actually going to be doing this subject tonight. And, you know, one of them got extremely upset. I don't know what was going on, but it's just... I've always felt like we should talk about everything. We should talk about the full picture of what's going on with topics. We should be open to learning and seeing what's going on. And, you know, healthcare, medicine, science is usually always evolving and it's based on more and more information that we get over time. And so the topic that I was looking at was natural immunity and how does that play a role in what's going on with COVID. I know things are extremely crazy right now. We've had an extremely high amount of cases. I believe it's over 3,000 this month. This is more than we've ever had. And we've had quite a few deaths. So a lot of people are very fearful. There's a lot going on. I believe there's more to it than just COVID because we have been over a year where we haven't had our healthcare services that have been available to people. We're seeing a combination of the risk factors, not having a good healthcare structure with COVID at play at the moment. So I think it's really a lot of different things that are going on. And so herd immunity, well, not herd immunity, but natural immunity is a very interesting topic that we don't seem to be talking about very much in terms of COVID-19 and what's happening, but it is starting to come up now in some of the data, some of the journals, the studies are being done, and that's what we're going to talk about tonight. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about what is immunity, active and passive immunity, and then I have a clip that I want everybody to listen to. It's about a new study that came out about natural immunity and how it plays a role in all of this moving forward. So we know that immunity to a disease is achieved through a presence of antibodies or some immune response that lingers over time. And usually antibodies are our measure for that, although there are other measures of immune response, T cells, all of those different cell lines that are involved in immunity. And it becomes very complicated for the regular person. So just to simplify it, everybody kind of knows after COVID a lot about antibodies being present. So when you have those inside the body and they are specific for a type of disease, then you are said to have immunity. That means when you encounter that disease again, your body already knows how to produce and neutralize antibodies or proteins that can neutralize the toxins or the organism itself. So you already kind of recognize what it is. You say, hey, I fought this before, I know what to do. And so the body responds quicker, better than it did when you had not responded before. Bodies are very specific to specific diseases. For example, if you got measles, if you encountered measles again, you wouldn't get it the way that you did the first time, but that may not help you. It doesn't help you really if you get exposed to another disease like mumps. So immunity falls into two different categories. So you have your active immunity and you have your passive immunity. So your active immunity is when you're exposed to a disease and that organism triggers your immune response to produce the antibodies to that specific disease, and that is your active immunity. The exposure can be through infection with the actual disease, which is what we're calling your natural immunity. So let's say you got COVID, you would be expected that most people would have natural immunity, and that's basic science. We know that with most diseases, if you get it, most illnesses like you'll have some natural immunity. Sometimes not completely, sometimes completely, but you do usually have some natural immunity if your body responded to it and you recovered. You can also get that active immunity through some form of vaccination. And that is kind of the theory behind people getting vaccinated, that they'll get some type of active immunity. And it depends on what they put in a vaccine to stimulate that response, but that's what they're hoping for, active immunity. Whether you get it or not depends on the body's response, if that vaccine works appropriately, the efficacy, as we say, of the vaccine. And then, of course, you have your passive immunity, which provides when a person is given antibodies, such as a baby when he drinks his mother's breast milk, he might actually have antibodies, but these do not last for a very long time. So they might last days or weeks. And that is becoming a very apparent in some of the new treatment modalities when it comes to COVID that's coming up. So passive immunity, it doesn't last as long. It mediates somewhat of a response, but the major advantage of passive immunity is that immediate protection, whereas active immunity usually takes time. The great thing about active immunity and what makes us decide if a vaccine is really good or working is its long-term immunity status. So you really want to have something that gives you long-term immunity. So 6 months, a year down the line, if you were to encounter this disease, then you would have the immune response where you would not get very, very sick. And that is what you want, and that's what expecting. Now, we all know that study in the United States, in the UK, we're seeing a waning response to the vaccine, especially in immunocompromised persons. So over time, the efficacy or the effect of it is not as strong. And so a lot of people have now started looking at natural immunity in a component in the fight against COVID, and how effective is it that people who have caught COVID have that long-term immunity status. And that's becoming a big play, especially in places like Europe, where they're requiring people to have vaccine passports and green passports, where they're saying, hey, do you have a negative test? Have you had COVID before? Or do you have the vaccine? They're kind of looking at all those different things as a role in this COVID pandemic. And so I heard a really, really interesting video that kind of outlays one of the most articles, well, studies about this exact thing. And so what we're going to do is we're going to listen to that, because there was a reporter on Hill TV that basically laid out a lot of the information that was found in the study. And then we're going to talk specifically about that study. And once we're done that, we're going to also open the line. So if you want to join in the conversation or have a question after we go through the video and we talk about the study, I'm asking everybody to kind of join in. So the numbers are 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Those are the station numbers, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. So after we are done with the video, we're going to talk about the study itself, and we are going to fit into everything that is going on. So producer, if you can play that video from the very beginning, that would be great.
A bombshell study released last week shows those previously infected with SARS-CoV-2 have natural immunity that offers 13 times more protection against the Delta variant than vaccination alone. The findings are from Tel Aviv. They followed over 700,000 people that were broken up into three different groups: those who were vaccinated with two doses of Pfizer, those who had recovered from a previous infection, and those who had recovered and received only one dose of the Pfizer vaccine. Now, the study found that those who had recovered from COVID were 13 times less likely to end up reinfected, concluding that natural immunity confers longer-lasting and stronger protection against infection, symptomatic disease, and hospitalization. Now, though the research increased benefit for those previously infected who also received one dose of the Pfizer vaccine, the researchers concluded the difference was statistically insignificant. So why would those who have natural immunity have a more robust immune response? The researchers hypothesize that it's because of B and T cell memory and the fact people who recovered from the virus are exposed to the entire virus, not just the spike protein the vaccines expose the body to. The study is yet to be peer-reviewed, but the findings are consistent with other studies and public health data. In July, the Israeli Health Ministry released data showing that of the nearly 850,000 Israelis known to have recovered from the virus, there were only 72 instances of reinfection, showing those with natural immunity were 6.5 times less likely to be affected by the Delta variant than those who were fully vaccinated. In May, the World Health Organization found that the 5% of people who recovered from COVID-19 had durable memories of the virus that remained fairly stable over time, only declining modestly at 6 to 8 months after infection. Also, six studies, which encompass nearly 1 million people from Qatar to Denmark to the U.S. Marines, all found that the range of reduction of reinfection from COVID-19 was between 82% to 95%, and found that naturally induced immunity resulted in extremely low rates of hospitalization and death in the event of repeat infection. Now, in the beginning, I said this was a bombshell study, but the reality is this shouldn't have been a bombshell at all. Conventional science has always held that previous infection results in robust immunity against reinfection from various viruses. However, for some strange politicized reason, for the past year and a half, this scientifically debated here in the U.S. But it wasn't always. In the instance of chickenpox, the CDC recommends vaccination for those who haven't had a previous infection. On their website, under the heading, "Who Needs a Chickenpox Vaccine?", the CDC says, quote, "People 13 years of age and older who have never had chickenpox or received chickenpox vaccine should get two doses at least 28 days apart," unquote. Same thing for the measles and even polio if they are not combined with other vaccines. Even during the smallpox outbreak, when vaccines became mandated, the certificate of immunity clearly gives clearance for those who had previously recovered from smallpox. So what's the difference now? Why suddenly, after over 100 years of recognizing previous infection as a robust form of immunity, are we suddenly rejecting science by forcing vaccines on absolutely everyone? Are public health officials just caving to the demands of a frightened public? Are they caving to the desires of greedy big pharma? In the European Union, where some countries have implemented vaccine passports, people can obtain one by either showing proof of vaccination, testing negative for the virus within 72 hours, or through proof of recovery from previous infection. This is based on sound science. So what is it that is causing this sudden rejection of widely accepted science here in the United States? We currently have colleges, corporations, big tech, politicians, and U.S. public health officials all openly excluding natural immunity as a basis for medical exemption. When recovered, patients raise an eyebrow over policies mandated they be vaccinated. Their educations, their livelihoods, and their ability to participate in society are threatened. Take, for example, Gianna Norris, a fiscal officer at Michigan State University. She recovered from COVID-19 and has naturally acquired immunity. Now, even though she recently received two antibody tests that demonstrate her robust immunity from reinfection, the university is threatening disciplinary action and termination if she does not comply with the school's mandatory COVID-19 vaccination policy. Now, she's currently suing. At George Mason University, professor of law Todd Zawicki had fully recovered from COVID-19, but was also being threatened with termination if he did not comply with mandatory vaccination.
Okay, that was a clip from it. She just kind of goes on into just a little more in depth of what's happening in the rest of the world in terms of how they are looking at it. And so the point isn't here to stop those who want to be vaccinated getting vaccinated. The point is, why are we broadening the discussion on COVID so that we have different pathways and different ways of looking at what's going on? This is the most strangest thing I've ever seen. This is the first time that, you know, only a particular brand of science seems to be able to be discussed, able to be put into mainstream. And so I'm thinking that, you know, about why we aren't looking at these different things that are happening. You know, a lot of countries are moving to treatment protocols and monoclonal antibodies and a lot of different things in our fight against COVID, because at the end of the day, we want to be rid of this. We want to be able to live normally. And so we want to be able to not put constraints on people and stress on people, but to find avenues where people can live safely. And so that was a big part of it. And so this study, which is called Comparing SARS-CoV-2 Natural Immunity to Vaccine-Induced Immunity, Reinfections versus Breakthrough Infections. Basically is looking at the fact that we have the longest immunity are the persons who've caught it. So it doesn't mean to go out and catch COVID, but we do know that at least 17,000-18,000, possibly more people have had COVID and do have some type of immune response. That goes into the new developments of this idea of not being able to get herd immunity from vaccines, because they do wane with variants. So if you are still passing COVID on to other people and you are still getting COVID, then the idea of herd immunity becomes another issue. And if we don't discuss these things ahead of time, it's very difficult for us to be proactive. I think it's important for us to be proactive rather than reactive. And I think that's where we have been taking most of our cues from, being quite reactive. We have a good idea of happening. And so let's try to grab the bull by the horn and say, you know, what is all the data out there? How can we use this to get back to a normalcy in such a way? And so vaccines may not be the thing that takes us out completely out of this pandemic, but we need to look at all the things that play a role in what's happening. So looking specifically at this article, at this study that came out, they did reporting on the waning because of the same reason I said. In their abstract, they say, reports of waning vaccine-induced immunity against COVID-19 have began to surface. With that, the comparable long-term protection conferred by previous infection with SARS-CoV-2 remains unclear. That's why they did this study, and this is what they ended up. They did a retrospective study, observational study, where they kind of went back looked at these different groups and then looked at how their infection rates were. And that's where the persons who had had COVID in the past actually came up on top. They saw a slight improvement with those who had gotten COVID and then got one shot, but it wasn't significant. It wasn't significantly better. And the persons who had been infected, actually, their immunity was lasting a lot longer, and you weren't seeing the degree of waning that you were seeing with the immunization, okay? And that's why a lot of parts of the world have already moved on to booster shots, because they're seeing that, and they're seeing that especially in those who are immunocompromised. And so that's something for us to think about as we are in the midst of our campaign. The conclusion of the study demonstrated that natural immunity confers long-lasting and stronger protection against infectious disease and hospitalization caused by the Delta variant of SARS-CoV-2 compared to Pfizer's vaccine, two-dose vaccine-induced immunity. Individuals who were both previously infected with SARS-CoV-2 and given a single dose of the vaccine gained additional protection, but it wasn't significant against the Delta. And the key thing there is the Delta. So the emergence of the variants have shown us that thing that really holds up most people. And so for the people who are even vaccinated, the ones who had COVID prior and then were also vaccinated were also more likely to be able to have a weaker or, you know, not get as sick with the new variant. So at the bottom line of it, the foundation was that. And so not everybody is going to get COVID. We hope that, you know, it starts to go away. But those people in the community, which I think is quite more than we even have reported, because you have to remember that earlier on, a lot of people were not getting tested. And so I'd really love to see a study on what our immunity status would be. That's the kind of work I would like to see happening inside the country, where we are, in fact, looking at, you know, who is immune versus who's not immune, who's in those risk groups, and how do we target the people specifically in the risk groups, and how do we deter people and get them out of those risk groups. We've had almost an entire year, and I would love to see a campaign focus on the risk stratification of persons who are in that high risk group of not doing well with COVID, and then dealing with them and specifically, you know, encouraging them to lessen the burden on society in terms of their reaction to COVID. But what we've seen is we've just seen a decline. A lot of people did not receive the care they need. They were no longer optimized. They weren't seeing the doctor. They stopped taking their meds. They got out of shape. They weren't running. They weren't exercising. And this further increases your risk for COVID-19. So I think what we're seeing now with these numbers is really a combination of everything that's happened over the past year, our lack of infrastructure, our lack of resources, the strain on the healthcare system, people not being able to get the healthcare services that they need, people not being advised to get out of their homes. In fact, we were telling them, stay in their houses, stay in your home, don't come out, don't exercise, you know, exercise in your yard. And people got lazy. A lot of people that I'm seeing now are ill because they have not been taking their medication. They are not coming out to the doctor. They were afraid or they were told not to. They stayed home. And so now we are trying to get people back to where they were. And so this is extremely important. So I'm getting comments from Dr. Crazy Smith. He says, is it ignoring science and not enough time to make conclusive, to make a conclusion in a sense. He also says here, we are 2 years in. As far as I'm concerned, we know very little at this point. Accessibility is the issue with all back and forth. I think you guys have a difficult task ahead, satisfying the masses. I think in terms of the masses, even sometimes I'm finding with my colleagues, some of the masses is more educated on what's going on than some of my own colleagues, because, you know, consistently reading and keeping up with this, because people's lives are at risk, the public has become very, very interested in COVID. And, you know, we are going from one extreme to the next. But what I'm saying is we are level-headed and logical approach to it all, kind of calm it all down. as a professional, if I am fearful and don't know what I'm doing, then I am going to create fear and panic in the community. It's up for me to cipher through the information, to make educated policy and decisions, to make considerations, to take people's personal health in line. And I talk about a lot of this stuff because I can see, looking around the world, how they're imposing on people what they should and should not do with their health. And they're not making exceptions, not being understanding, and they're not kind of, you know, allowing people to have the type of information they need to make the right decisions for them. I think if we had taken a different response from the very beginning of COVID, we may not have been here. I think some of the policy decisions that were made have led us to where we are. And now we have, you know, a lot more problems. Because what I would have liked to have seen, and I thought this was why we had locked down in the first place, was to see an expansion of our healthcare services, the type of educational programs that would have let people know about their risks, what was going on with COVID, and how they could detour that. Because at the end of the day, your risk factors are the same NCDs that we have been preaching about for a very long time. Looking at the data in the Bahamas, we see that the persons who've actually passed away from COVID, and I'm sorry, I don't want anyone to be dying from COVID. I work with patients who call me about COVID, and luckily, thank God, you know, none of my patients have had to go seriously into hospital or pass away. So I take that thing because we work very early on to combat symptoms. We start a very early treatment program. And I have a very positive approach because I feel like if 99.6% of the world who had COVID recovered, then why shouldn't my patients be in that category? The 0.4%, you know, sadly, we have death in life and it's very, very sad. We don't want anyone to die. And if we can make that number zero, I think that would be amazing. But we have to work early on. We have to have a more positive outlook. And we need early intervention. Early intervention, because we, as we can see with what's going on, COVID does not seem to be going away. I believe it's going to become endemic, and it's going to be something that we're going to have to learn to live with. And we need to now be proactive in our policy in order to combat these things. And a big part of that is the structure. And so if we're not going to do those things, then we are going to continue to have a breakdown in our system. Sadly, in the brink of all of this, you know, I don't really like to get political, but I have. Yes, yeah, so they said some Vanessa Colby online says, have you heard of Dr. Pollard from the UK is saying that it is unlikely that herd immunity will be reached, and that thinks going forward they should only test persons who are symptomatic and report on hospitalizations rather than positive cases. It is thought that we all get it at some point. And I agree with Dr. Pollard. I've never been for mass testing, and I think it's a part of the hysteria and a part of what seems to be almost a fanaticism that's going on with COVID. And it's because we've been locked down for over a year. And we hear death rate numbers daily. We have never done this before. And so there is a lot of fear. And I would like to show everybody that, you know, we can take this from a calmer approach and look at the glass half full instead of half empty, focus on the 99.6% that will survive, then I think we would have better outcomes. Wendy DeVoe online says, good evening. Which entity should be responsible for this level of research? We have data of individuals testing positive. Has anyone taken the initiative to compare reinfection rates of the past cases in the Bahamas vaccinated compared to see those who were not? I do not think any of this is happening currently. I would say that the Ministry of Health, you know, I enjoy research. Research requires resources. So if I was to encounter or do something like this, I'd love to be involved, just need the resources to do it. And so I think most of our health, and so that would be a great place for that to start. You need an epidemiologist involved. You need different persons to participate in the study. And of course, you'd have to get ethical consideration. But as you can see, these scientists did a retrospective study, which meant that they looked back at data. So they didn't really need to be doing something ongoing. They were able to say, hey, 2020, April, all these people caught COVID. These people were vaccinated. Let's look at their status. And they were able to see it from there. So this is a study that we could do here in the Bahamas since we have started our own vaccine program. And that will give us information as we move forward. So very good questions. Talking about Dr. Pollard, I actually was going to speak on an article that he is involved with about herd immunity. This is the person online mentioned. And it talks about in London. So this was in CNBC, which is the media company. And they did an article where they pulled together and actually interviewed different scientists from different places, including the scientists that's involved in Pfizer. And what it said was, and this happened in London itself, achieving herd immunity with COVID vaccines when the highly infectious Delta variant is spreading is not a possibility, a leading epidemiologist said. Experts agree on several reasons why such a goal where overall immunity in a population is reached and the spread of the virus is stopped is not likely. Sir Andrew Pollard, head of the Oxford Vaccine Group, told British lawmakers Tuesday that as COVID vaccines did not stop the spread of the virus entirely, with vaccinated people still able to infect and transmit the virus, the idea of achieving herd immunity was mythical. I think we're in a situation here where the current variants, where herd immunity is not a possibility because it still infects vaccinated individuals, said Pollard, one of the lead researchers in the creation of AstraZeneca University of Oxford vaccine. So he was actually involved with that, and he realized from the data that's coming out from places like Israel and around the world that it may not be possible. The variants are changing that. And that's where the idea of the study came from that I just had you guys listen to, because of the fact of this waning. People who are proactive know that we now need to start looking at other avenues and start creating protocols that are inclusive of those things. Because a lot of people have been saying that, you know, their jobs want them to get vaccinated and da da da. Don't call me an anti-vaxxer or anything like that. I'm pro-vaccine in terms of all the standard immunizations out there, but I believe people deserve personal choice. They need to make educated and informed decisions, and no one should be forced, because as time goes on, we are finding out more and more and more information that is adding to our pool of data for us to make correct policy decisions. So we don't just want to do anything that because the rest of the world is doing it. We can learn from the rest of the world. And as we can see, the rest of the world is already shifting gears towards doing things slightly different. They might still be going along with their vaccination programs because I think they're already in it, but they're now opening possibilities for other things, right? So we don't need to fight about that. We don't need to fight about who's vaccinated, who's not vaccinated. My approach is, because I have patients who are both vaccinated and unvaccinated, people make choices for different reasons. People have individual health concerns, and we need to be more specific in the way that we look at this, right? That is my whole idea. Okay, yeah, sorry guys, my voice is a bit low. And they're saying that it's a little bit shaky, so I'm sorry about that. You can also catch me here on Guardian Radio and also on the app. So that's kind of where that's coming from. That article that we talked about from CNBC then goes on to talk about what is herd immunity and why it's really not possible, and how you have to kind of also incorporate this idea of natural immunity and natural infections. It goes on to say, but what is herd immunity? Put simply, herd immunity relates to the idea that a high level of immunity to a virus in the population can achieve by which and by vaccination. The later method is preferred because we would love to have a vaccine that overwhelmingly creates immunity without causing illness or adverse health complications, which happens usually in the natural infection. So you don't really want to get natural infection COVID is pretty nasty, even though it's a flu-like disease. And even for those who survive, it is a pretty nasty flu-like disease. And it's just something that a lot of people do not want to go through. So yes, Claudette Grant, vaccine should be choice. I am pro-choice on that. I am not the person who's going to force you to do anything. I am going to provide you with information. And then depending on your risk assessment, your decision is made. And that's how it should be. I am not political or pro this or pro that or anti this or anti that. I am all about patient-centered teaching, education, learning. That's how I was trained. And I don't think even within the midst of that, I will change that, because I think that is the best way to achieve good health outcomes. If you do not include your patient in their choice, then what are you really doing? Okay, I am not there to put a gun to your head to do anything. I am there to give you information, provide you advice, be able to examine what your risk factors are, what's right for you, what's not right for you, and you know, give you all the information I can. Whatever I know, I'm open to telling you. So just to conclude with that, so they still go on to talk about vaccines and, you know, preferences and all that kind of stuff like that. But the point is that it's now coming to mainstream. So if I had said this 6 months ago or 4 months ago, you know, everyone would kind of look at you strange. And that's the kind of issue with today and why things are moving and progressing so slowly, because there seems to be a very narrow view of how to deal with this. As a scientist and someone who believes in science and study, you know, my mind is always open to new possibilities. And so I like to have a discussion. You bring your data, I bring my data, and let's hash it out and see what makes sense. And that's really how, to me, science is supposed to be. If I cannot talk about a particular issue, if I, you know, if I have to think a certain way, then that is not science. As some doctor said to me today, it's consensus. And, you know, consensus is how they do things in cabinet. You know, it doesn't really matter if it makes sense. If we all agree, then, you know, there, that's what you have. And so I don't really believe it's all sat down and looked at the data. And so it is data driven rather than just emotions. And so I think we have to be strong for our patients and let people know that there is an opportunity to beat this, whether it be your natural immunity, whether it be being proactive, early treatment. And then for those people who want to be vaccinated, that is an option. So if you want to join in the conversation, if you have a question or you have something to say, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. I think if we take the pressure off of people, you know, people will make the choice that is correct for them with that. So that was a big part of what we were talking about tonight. And so as we go along and see if there's anyone who wants to join with us, how do we then boost our immune system? That is extremely important. And you hear me talk about it quite often. Boosting your immune system, having a strong immune system in the first place, means that your health has to be optimized. And so starting off, whether you're vaccinated or unvaccinated, I tell everybody that you need to optimize your health. Whatever issues you have, whatever comorbidities you have, if you're overweight, if you're extremely obese, then, you know, these are the things that we need to work on. So the idea of boosting your immune system can seem quite elusive, you know, because it's hard to tell a connection sometimes. But if you focus on the things that we consider to be the things that help your health in general, you know, diet, exercise, you have to take your age into consideration. You think stress, a lot of people have been going through a lot of stress. Stress affects your immune system, the way that you react to things in your environment, the way that you deal with illness. All of that is quite related to the immune response in animals and in humans. And so over time, people have been studying at this, looking at this, looking for proven ways to benefit and help their health system and strengthen their immune system. And so very basic things that you can do right away is, of course, persons who smoke need to stop smoking. You know, smoking is related to everything. Okay. So Vanessa Colby says online, a few weeks ago, you had some doctors who are open to outpatient treatment of COVID positive persons. Is that number of practitioners growing at this time? I would say that there are definitely some doctors who are definitely doing it. Some are even going to people's homes. I take an approach I do where I do virtual consults. With first thing is that you let me know early. So if you have a positive COVID result, you let me know early. I think there are other doctors who are doing it as well, but they're a lot more quiet because even within medicine, there is like this cliquishness around this whole thing. And, you know, people want to put you in boxes of how you do something. And so if you're not specifically speaking a certain narrative, you know, it's something that people have decided, hey, I'm just going to keep it to myself and personally treat my patients. And I'm just going to just not get involved in all of this. So you see that in a lot of areas in this country. When there is, I guess, the consensus on a particular view. So I think the number of doctors doing that is growing. I think as more and more data comes out, as more doctors realize that there are opportunities to do something different, you will have that, right? So the list is actually bigger than it seems. It's just sadly, a lot of people can't be as open with their approach. Me, I don't believe in having any fear in these things. If it's going to be something that's going to be helpful to someone, such as early prevention or treatment during early stages of COVID, then we need to have that out there. Because unlike this whole idea of just sitting at home and waiting until things get really worse, I don't think it's possible. There's a lot of things that you can do that are very helpful in keeping you out of hospital. And that should be the key, because we know the healthcare system does have its issues right now. And so people want to be out of hospital. So of course, exercise regularly, maintain a healthy weight. If you drink alcohol, only in moderation, get adequate sleep. So I can't say this enough, because I find that a lot of behavior sleep, 7-8 hours of sleep is what we consider adequate sleep. So if you are sleeping 5-4 hours a day, you know, you're not gonna be your best. Your body's gonna be extremely stressed, and you're gonna be open to disease, you know? So stress and, you know, all and sleep all go together. And I know it's hard because there's a financial and there's an economic component to what's happening. So people are really kind of stressed anyway. People are really kind of stressed. And this is why we need to be proactive and put the kind of policies and strategies in place so people can get back to work safely. Trying to minimize stress, we talked about keeping current with all recommended medications and anything needed to fight off your immune system. And so I take a very natural approach to precautionary things, you know, taking your vitamins, vitamin C. I looked at a study just the other day. I'll see if I can pull it up. But what it showed was that about 85% of the persons who were in hospital for COVID actually had extremely low levels of vitamin C. So they think, oh, you know, people are telling everyone to take vitamin C, but vitamin C is actually a really crucial component of it. So when people are stressed and they have viruses, their vitamin C levels apparently go really, really down. And so those of us who have been kind of, you know, pushing this whole idea of taking your supplements and stuff like that, there is science that is backing a lot of that. You have some hospitals that are also giving intravenous vitamin C. I do that with quite a few of my patients if they've had COVID. As well, to kind of top them up, because you hear people talking about this post-COVID syndrome or, you know, just not being back to normal. And that happens in a lot of viral illnesses as well as infections or viral illness. So I was treating patients kind of for these like post-viral syndrome even before COVID had come about. One of the first patients that I treated here in the Bahamas with vitamin C was actually a post-viral syndrome. He had had a very bad viral illness and he just never recovered. You know, it was like 2 years later and he still was not optimized. So we were optimizing him with IV vitamins at that point in time. So that's very interesting to see that when they did measure the levels of vitamin C in these patients, that they in fact were extremely low. That was something that came out of one of the studies that I saw. And so I'm just going to open up the phone lines again. 232-325-4316, 325-4259. If you want to join in the conversation, if you have a comment or anything, if you have anything to say about what's happening, give me a call, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. So someone's asking about the vitamin C. You can give me a call at my clinic, 326-1521, and we can discuss about the vitamin C. Very, very helpful, because what we do find is that taking vitamin C orally, you can only get so much. I think you mentioned one of the doctors who was on a few weeks ago. She was talking about taking it orally and taking it in, you know, small doses, because you don't take in a large amount of vitamin C orally. If you want to get higher doses of vitamin C, you need to take it via the science of this comes a lot from, and this, most of the studies have been done in cancer patients, usually in Europe. A lot of those studies have come out of Europe, where they basically were using vitamin C to help as an adjuvant to chemotherapy and helping a lot of those patients who are on really hard chemo drugs. And, you know, because there are different properties to vitamin C at different levels. You know, there is both the oxidative and kind of the reductive values of vitamin C, depending on how much of it you use and the dosage that you use. So higher levels of vitamin C, you start to see different properties coming out. And so that's how it. Thank you, Claudette. Thank God for those doctors that take a different approach in treating COVID. Yes, we have to have a multiple prong approach. There is not just one way, and we need the key really is early interventions. Patients that I have seen who have come in early, who have said, hey, doc, I have COVID, you know, we monitor them. We make sure that they're okay. And we start them on protocols right away, depending on what type of symptoms they've had and depending on their risk stratification, because people have different risks. So a 14-year-old kid with COVID, you know, you're not going to have, it's very rare that they're going to have really bad illness. Maybe an older person, 40s, 50s, 60s, who have multiple comorbidities, you know, they're going to be at the higher risk of this all. And as I was mentioning earlier, what we were seeing on the Bahamian data is that, unlike the rest of the world, where a lot of, this is the most recent data that I've seen, a large pool of the persons who were being hospitalized were persons in the kind of like 45 to 60 age range, which is not as the normal pattern. This is the importance of looking at data right here at home and kind of making that analysis of what's going on in your country specifically into that context. Okay, we'll get back to that. Caller, you're on the air.
Hi, good evening. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Hey, Bless, thanks. First time calling your show, but I've always admired you. One, because you espouse Christian principles, and I've seen you give glory to God. So that's definitely commendable, and I try to follow you as much as possible. And I heard the video that you played, at least the audio from the video that you played,
yeah,
which I thought was like, wow, I hadn't heard that. I was following because I'm unvaccinated. And, you know, I was questioning because I'm trying to say, maybe my body could recover. But you, everywhere you turn, I mean, the media, there's this constant push. And even intelligent people,
yes,
even people who don't necessarily fall into pressure, being pressured into this because they're not hearing the facts. But coming from you as a doctor, not just some fly-by-night person who's claiming to be a doctor, that should give value. It certainly does to me, listening to what you have to say. And I really appreciate it, and I heard you give an ad. I think your sponsor tonight, I'm not sure if that's your clinic, but I'm not
it's my clinic.
Just,
the show is brought to you by me.
Yeah, no problem. I intend to register, and I'm going to use, I think you said y'all do the registration, y'all assist with registration or something?
Yeah, sure. Give us a call in the morning, anytime after 9, between 9 and 4, 326-1521. We'll get you registered.
Okay, so what I'll do, if you could say it maybe in the next 5 minutes, because I don't have any pen, I'll take that down and I will call.
Yeah.
But I just want to continue. If there are other doctors in the Bahamas who will share your view on the natural, immunity that the body can produce, and then using this report as a guide and whatever other reports exist, I think if you all were to come out in a public forum, then it gives ammunition to those who are resistant and a good health enough feeling that they don't have no comorbidities, they don't have no underlying conditions. They perhaps are willing to say, you know, I don't want to be vaccinated. I really just want to, if I get it, I will follow the protocols, but I want my body to really handle this.
So,
I believe a lot of people, there are many people, and those are some of the reasoning. Sorry, you had a question.
Thank you, caller, for calling in. Yes, I do believe you should have the right. Nothing should be done out of fear or coercion. And that's what a lot of people are actually saying to me. So I don't like how that feels, that people are saying, you know, like, I didn't want to do it and I just did it because of X, Y, and Z. I think we need to re-rationalize how we're approaching this and what we're doing. And I think a lot of it is fear. Even the doctors are very fearful. I don't think I don't want to say it like that, but, you know, are they really kind of reading and kind of taking in all of this? I think, you know, this pandemic is something that we've never kind of seen before in our lifetime. And there was so much going on. It all happened so fast. And we just didn't have a moment to kind of sit back and rationalize what was really going on here. You know, COVID is real and people are dying. Are we doing this correctly? Do we have another approach? Can we look at people as individuals rather than just kind of the group? And can we stratify their risk factors and see, you know, what's happening there? I just think there's a lot of information that we're not kind of tapping into that would make this a lot successful. And you have to understand that this may not be the popular view for most physicians who are involved. I know there are physicians who do think like this. Some of them just haven't had an opportunity. We had some doctors who had their own views. And those doctors were talking about ivermectin and other medications, which I don't really use, but that was their treatment protocol. That's what they were using. They were having success with their patients. My approach is very much more, I think, on the natural side of things, but these are options that people have. And if they're working, should we take a look at them? I'm just saying we need to be open to more than, because we do have data of how this is playing out, and we should not try to force people to do anything. I definitely believe in advocating for patients and their choice. People have different risk factors. People have risk factors when it comes to vaccination. Some people are going to do very well with vaccination. And, you know, this is something that a conversation you should have. What I think is important for every person is that you have a conversation with your doctor. You also speak to them about your risk factors, what you can do to improve yourself, optimize yourself in terms of health overall, because this is COVID, but if anything else comes along, do you want to be in that high-risk group of people, regardless of what it is? I think this is a time for us to reflect as a nation on our health in general and make a determination of what we're going to look like in the next 5 to 10 years. This is like a warning, because luckily this disease is only killing a fraction of people. But is this a warning to something greater? We have to not take that very lightly. And I think that we really have to look at that right now. And then whoever ends up leading this country best in healthcare, early intervention, and education. You know, when I went to China, what I realized about them, even though they're a communist country, I don't believe in the way that they do things in a lot of ways. But when it comes to ensuring what their future looks like, they're extremely good. You know, if they want the country to be kind in 10 years, you're going to learn about kindness. You're not going to go anywhere without learning about being kind. And so we have an opportunity to educate, because I see the children, and the children are eating the same thing as the parents, and everybody is going down the same track, and you hear them, people coming in, and your mom had hypertension and your daddy had diabetes, and everyone is just going down the same road. And so in the long run, educating people is important. And I think this is the first time that you're going to have Bahamians actually listening in, because there is a deaf component directly in front of you. So regardless of whatever you decide to do, vaccinate, not vaccinate, whatever you decide to do, you need to take responsibility for your health. You need to take responsibility of how you're living. You have to be hygienic and follow the rules as much as possible. You know, so we can get back to normal. We don't need to have tons of people inside the hospital, but we've been having tons of people in the hospital for quite some time. I look at the death rate in the country between last year and this year, and the rate of difference between 2019 and 2020 was about 1.3%, 1.3%. 1.3%, and the year before that was 1.03%. So it didn't go up significantly, but it did go up a little bit. But positively, what that tells us is there wasn't such a drastic increase in deaths overall, but there was a slight increase in deaths. And so no death is a good thing. People are going to die, but for those persons that can remove themselves from that risk group, this is your opportunity right now. What I wanted people to get from this was, do not lose hope. We can see now with information that persons who did have COVID before actually have pretty good immune response that's lasting a long time, even longer than the vaccine in light of new variants. So not everybody is dying. 99.6% of people are not gonna die. And if you look at Bahamian statistics, out of the 17,000 people, you know, they're saying close to 400 have died. That's about 2% of the 4% of the people who have gotten it. So 4% of the population have gotten COVID. 2% of those people did not make it through. Nobody wants to be a part of the 2%. But what I'm seeing in the healthcare system is that across the board, the people that are not doing well are falling into that same high risk group that we talked about. Extremely obese, not optimized on their medication. You know, they're just unhealthy people. And we all need to do, you know, I just had a baby. I'm not my ideal weight. And that's something that I'm working on. And we all have to continue to keep working towards something better. You know, a lot of people are being saved also by their age. But, you know, that's a discussion. Have a discussion with your doctor. Go in and have a physical. See where you are in terms of your healthcare. And so for any other callers, 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. And for that caller that wanted the clinic number, it's 326-1521. We can get you signed up for NHI. You know, it's a good opportunity to get your physicals done as well. So I would say use that resource definitely in what's going on. And so those are some of the key things that we kind of talked about. And I wanted to really get through it because, and I want people to be open to knowing that there is data out there. Do not do anything in fear or coercion. Don't do anything. You know, if you have a question, if you have a fear, discuss it with your physician. All right? And you know, if you need to discuss with someone else, do it with someone else. Because at the end of the day, your health is your priority and in your hand. And I think what we've seen with this is this approach of person's health or not their personal responsibility, but the responsibility of the community or the government or whoever else, it doesn't really work. What you need is people understanding where they fit in terms of their risk and deciding how they're going to deal with that. You need buy-in. If you don't have buy-in, you know, you're not going to get a really good outcome. So all this aggressive talk and stuff like that, I think it needs to stop. I think we all need to get together. We all need to figure our way out of this. And there's been a lot of divisiveness. I really don't like it. I don't think that this is a time to be divisive on this subject. This is a time for us to come together as a community and figure this out. And I think a lot of our issues lie with the fact that we do not have a healthcare system that is supporting our needs. And this was happening for quite some time. Comment online, are discussions taking place among medical professionals in the Bahamas on a large scale to share varying viewpoints regarding COVID treatments, interventions, and vaccinations? Open discussion among those who are in the forefront of this pandemic may help to initiate constructive debate and a better action plan. I totally agree. Like I said, there are a lot of people who are not open to this. They're not open to the discussion. You know, I'm in some of the groups and they're not, and some people are just not open to it. Some are open to it. Some are just not open to it. You know, and we should be working together. We should be working together. But, you know, if you are so far on one side and, you know, that you can't listen to anything else, you know, we don't solve problems well like that. I have a very open mind. You show me the proof, you show me the data, you show me whatever, I'm willing to listen. We can talk about it, we can debate, and let's come up with a solution after that. What I realized is we were missing this kind of early intervention talk. We were missing this kind of aspect of it. And I think we need to fill some of those gaps and we'll have better outcomes. And that's what we want. We don't just want a particular outcome. That's not how I practice medicine. I want the best or better outcome. So even if it's not the popular view, if it falls in line with science, if it falls in line with practicality, taking into consideration our culture of our people, all of those things have to be a part of it. You cannot cut and paste what you see being done around the world and just expect it to work. You need to look at specifically what's happening there. And I think a big part of it is we need to do some of our own studies. We need to poll our own people and we need to just take a slightly different approach. Because there is always more than one way of dealing with something, right? And if we're not accepting of the fact that people want to take different approaches, you know, that's where the problem comes in. And there's nothing wrong with that. People have always given alternative choices. You know, when you might go to a doctor and he says you need to do X, Y, and Z. You're like, you know, I don't know if I'm ready to commit to that. Let me try something else. Because you have a choice in life. And we shouldn't be coming down on people on that. What we should be doing is strengthening our healthcare system, putting in the infrastructure to support what we're doing right now, and I think we've had a lot of time to do that. That's why we went through a lot of this stuff. That's why I think our community of physicians sat back a lot during the lockdowns and all these different things, because we wanted to give the people in charge an opportunity to get it all together. But if I think that there can be some helpful things that can help people early, I think as a physician, it's my duty to say that you need to focus as well on prevention and early intervention. Extremely important. And so just a few last points, because I know the producer will have to go home, so we might have to end early. So I'll give anybody any other opportunity to call in 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. You're here with me, Dr. D, on the Doctor's Zen. Of course, I'm a family medicine specialist and consultant. And I believe in, you know, providing the education and looking at things from different points of views. And I think if we collectively start to think about this in a broader sense, that we'll have a better outcome in the way that we've been dealing with COVID-19. So we ended kind of a little bit on, you know, just some of the things to do to improve your immunity. And of course, you know, at this time, I think supplementation is very important because we don't always get the nutrition that we need. The ultimate way to get any type of supplements or nutrients is from our food. Sadly, we import a lot of our food. The nutrient levels are low. So I also would like to tell people that, you know, a good way of getting a source of nutrients is your local fruits and vegetables and stuff like that. So, you know, the things that are in season, avocados, canapes, you know, have a lot of vitamin C. I think if we go back a little bit too to our indigenous, you know, foods in the sense of naturally growing foods, it's very good too. Not to the peas and rice and the macaroni, you just have that on the weekend, everybody. But, you know, things that have been growing locally, you find that those things also work well with the people in those communities as well. So your local fruits, whatever is available and whatever is in season, it's a good time. We have another caller. Sorry, I totally didn't see that caller if you're on the air. Caller, are you still there? Caller, I'm sorry, I didn't see you. If you want to call back, you can do that. Caller, are you there?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Okay, I can hear you. Yes.
Yeah. Good night. How are you doing, Dr. Archer?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, I'm struggling. You know, I guess they suspended all the clinical appointments. They have to call the workshop and et cetera and get their appointment and all that. But I think a great mistake was when they moved Dr. Sands from the Minister of Health. He has an open mind also, and so I will call you the Doctor of Truth, okay? And so this show, I really appreciate this because, of course, you know, I've already saw the studies and the data coming out of Israel, right?
Yes.
And so the thing is, I'm noticing everything is suiting their paradigm. Now, all of a sudden, there's a inescapable monoclonal antibody inducement treatment, right? So Etrivimab, right? So it's proven effective. The FDA has approved it. And so we knew, you know, I know you've heard me mention monoclonal antibodies on the radio for over a year now, right?
But, you know, they've been using it, right? It only really burst on the scene recently because Governor Abbott, a gentleman who is vaccinated, the minute he found out that he had COVID, he went for monoclonal antibody treatment. That's what really caused it to be buzzed out there that, you know, it's approved and it's out there. So that means a lot, and a lot of people were taking it in Florida.
I called Juan Cho some time ago. Juan had given me credence for mentioning it. He remembered me always talking about it. He brought it up. And so it was a lady working in the States in a lab, and she actually called and verified that it works. But here's what we need. Mr. Doctor, I just like your shows. You know, you're so real. Listen to me. The thing is, if they was really interested in saving lives, we would have they would have implemented other source of medical intervention cures, right? Like for COVID-19, instead of just saying vaccine. Now they find out viral immune escape. And so what happens is, at viral immune escape, they know that what happens is, as the virus gets familiar with the host body, the virus has actually found a way to hike a ride on the transient components of the innate immune system, like the macrophages, et cetera, dendrites, et cetera, and find a way to infect become cell-mediated infections. And it's complicated. And so, you know, I don't even want to get into that part, but the thing is, the other day when you had the last show, those doctors seemed lost, you know, as if doctors have a behind their name and they don't want to admit they don't know everything. When I mentioned about the vitamin D having immune receptors on basically every cell in the body for immunity. And, you know, vitamin D plays a role in a lot of things, especially inflammation and gut biome. So vitamin D is an integral part of the immune system. And so, I just like what you're stressing, but what I'm saying is the media is a part of the problem, too, because I saw where they have on the headline, Doomsday variant. They call it the C12 variant coming out of Africa. Why is this Doomsday variant up to be coming out of Africa, even though it's already spread all about? And so, of course, you know, I was always saying, the vaccine was a farce because of antigenic shift and drift and reassortment. So herd immunity is a fleeting illusion. Me and you know that. But Dr. D, you don't have to be smart. If you understand the science and you follow it like how I do, because I know they just lie, you and Warren and Michelle are the closest thing you're the closest thing to a scientific journalist, right? Of course, we would be kidnapped by science because we are mostly ignorant about it, right? But I'm not too pleased about what I'm seeing because you have fluvoxamine, bomblender, lots of treatments, remdesivir, but the steroids. But the thing is, even from Ebola, when they used convalescent patients' antibodies to hasten the amount of antibody count to fight the Ebola, because Ebola virus multiplied so fast, the immune system, by the time it recognized it, it wasn't able to overcome the amount of pathogen. And so it basically is the same concept. So when I heard about monoclonal antibodies, that's a concept that I learned years ago, because I realized you can induce antibodies into the cells, into the human body, and augment the innate immune system. But what I want to express is, when you induce a immune response via a vaccination or a real pathogen, the immune system response is still the same. So it doesn't matter. The fact that viral immune escape is the same thing, like when you keep using bagon, the viruses learn how to work around that. And so,
yeah.
And so one of the ways the virus does that is by mutating faster and also morphing, changing its shape.
But you see, caller, you have to wait until mainstream media is okay with providing this information. Listen to me. If not, it gets shut down. And so, like from last year, a lot of the things that I was mentioning is just coming out now. And so, you know, when I said some of those things, you got a little
even in our
community, which is supposed to be science based, they don't have an open mind to a lot of this stuff.
It's not science based. That's why I was saying certain people was, you know, they was talking bad about me on the radio, right?
A lot of people don't understand what you're talking about. That's the problem,
But don't criticize me in ignorance. Tell me, like last week, Saturday, when I talked with Don them on the week, saying the mRNA, I said the spike protein. And I was talking about the molecular events in which the transfer RNA takes the mRNA to the ribosomes and create the protein factory to create the spike protein. So what I'm saying is, I was trying to stress that the fact that the transfer RNA is my transfer RNA. The mRNA is the vaccine mRNA. So the transfer RNA forms the anticodons, and the mRNA forms the codons. So that's a double-stranded DNA. And C means complementary, meaning it has to be done through reverse transcription. I don't know what I'm talking about. But what I'm glad you mentioned is the breakthrough cases and the reinfection. And I saw the data, and you know, the natural immunity is proving to be superior, and this is what they're hiding. So the fact that they're not even mentioned, you don't hear terminology like antibody-dependent enhancement, viral immune escape, certain jargons from the health professionals over here. It's really scary. I know Dr. Nikia Forbes came on and mentioned some things, and you know, my fault is I'm too emotional, and it's caused me to stammer, and then if I slow down, people don't really get what I'm saying and appreciate what I'm saying.
I understand your passion, caller, But, you know, when you put a lot out there all at once, you know, a lot of people aren't following it. The lay people don't really know what's going on. You know, I'm not an immunologist, but, you know, I study this stuff. And to me, before I speak on anything, I ensure that I know what I'm talking about. I try to do a lot of research.
But the thing is, what they're saying about this new...
Keep up with it.
What they're saying about this new doomsday C12 strain variant is that it spreads 1.7 to 1.8 times faster. And so a lot of things that I've been mentioning, Dr. D, the amount of reading I've done, when I listen to the people talk, I know they don't know the science, you know, because they don't want no objectivity in their discussions. And so this is scary.
Anybody who doesn't want you to ask questions is a problem, right? So when you say that it's transmitted 1.7 times more, I ask you, like, you know, what's the virulency of that, you know? Because
what I'm saying is, if you follow this science, you would have questions to ask if you really understand it, right or wrong.
You have to ask questions.
Yes, I have a lot of questions.
Without asking questions, right? All good science usually comes from observational view as first. I saw this. I see there might be some correlation. I then forego and study it. Yeah, if you do not ask questions,
I lost a cousin.
I
lost a cousin to COVID a couple of days ago, and it was really painful because me and him the same age, and he's my childhood cousin, and we grew up together. Mm-hmm. It is really painful, you know. And he was a bit overweight, but he was always strong. And they said he was on oxygen, but I didn't. Yeah. I guess I interpreted just being on the oxygen tank versus the intubation where you have to be put to sleep. And so the fact that there are other augmented respiratory technology different from euthanizing a patient and putting them to sleep. I'm vexed that we're not innovating in many lights as far as Inogen and other augmented respiratory technology that we're delving into. So we're in the dark ages, right, with Dr. D. This is a joke.
Well,
and we're being kept in the dark by being given disinformation, misinformation, and subterfuge.
To be innovative, you first have to be able to ask questions. Right? And then find the answers to those questions.
You know, the school system is designed for conformity. This is why, you know, I've had a doctor lie to me on the radio, right? And about the herpes virus and the Epstein-Barr virus being the same virus. He said no, but he was too ashamed. How about them couldn't even answer some of my questions? But this is what it is.
It's slightly different. Let's not go into all of that. I think the key parts of this is that we need to ask questions. We have to look for different answers. We need to be proactive in all of this. We have to be open to different ways of dealing with this.
I would like you to comment on something I'll say right before I hang up.
All right, sure.
Because what happens, all right, you know the immune system, all right, monoclonal antibodies are made in the lab, right? And so the immune system has polyclonal antibodies. That means a team of antibodies targeting more than a specific pathogen, and they respond to different epitopes on the antigens of the pathogens, right? And so what I'm saying is our innate... Listen, man, as a doctor, I was studying the dendritic cells for 16 years. These are the people who I listen to. You know, I listen to doctors who have protein...
You have to finish your thought process, caller. That's where you're going to lose people. You got to finish that thought process. So you asked me a question and you jumped on something else.
But Dr. D, I don't know if the data showed that the innate immune system is quite robust, and the fact that the antibodies, because they actually produce when needed, as the viral load decreases, then the antibody increase. I mean, Dr. D, why I mention some of these things is they're still learning about the immune system, you know. I just want the public to know that. There's people who know it all. You listen to so many different doctors and you get so much mind views. You get a better outlook of it, like the concept of viral immune escape. That was just discovered in the 80s. So some of these doctors have no idea what you're even talking about. But, you know, it's always good, and I'd like for you to keep it up. God help you. Dr. D, this might be the last time you even hear from me because, you know, everybody's having a problem. Anything can happen. This is what it is. Be afraid to live and be afraid to die.
Don't say that, caller. Have a positive outlook. Guess what? There's always light at the end of the tunnel.
I guess my sunlight nights don't eat meat and all that, but that don't secure me because... I feel like when I see some blood, I have problems with blood clots. You know, I don't know if it's some post surgery or whatever, but you know, blood clots are pretty on dangerous grounds, right?
Yeah, you're on medication for that.
They might actually get the desire because none of us can be here forever. But I don't have no problem with dying because I look and see trees die who never curse nobody and rob and thief and still die. So I don't have a problem with dying.
Thank you, caller. Thank you. He always has a really good contribution. I just always try to tell him to bring it together, but thank you very much. You know, he's just talking about monoclonal antibodies and polyclonal. Yes, our bodies do have a lot of those things. And you know, we use what we learn from the body to create medicines to do certain things. And those things are extremely important. I think, I guess maybe because I take it from a spiritual approach that, you know, God gives us some of this insight and allows us to use knowledge to create pathways to, you know, producing medicines and different things and stuff like that. But we always have to keep on searching for knowledge in order to be doing the right thing. So as a doctor, you are to do no harm. So you want to make sure that your patients are safe as possible. So have that conversation. Talk about your health. Comment online says, sadly, our culture does not celebrate critical thinking or asking questions. People who challenge the norm are commonly labeled troublemakers. Exactly. And so that is something... I think it's a part of the reason why we are finding it very difficult to progress as a society, because we do not like critical thinking. We do not like people to come out of the box. We don't like people who have a different point of view, and we need to be more open towards those things, because how can you progress or get new ideas if you are kind of stifled with the same old ideas, the same people dictating to everybody else what needs to be done. There is so much more out there. The world is global. There's information for us all. We're continually learning. We're continually learning as doctors, as scientists, as regular people in the community. And so we should all be seeking knowledge. We should all contribute. You don't understand, you ask questions, you find out how. That's the way that I was brought up, you know. And I don't like the fact that we're kind of going away from that. And nobody's going to tell me how I should think. I think I'm smart enough to understand things for myself, make decisions for myself, and be able to understand the information that's out there. So that's the kind of the key thing that's going on there. And there is so much other stuff out there that we need to bring into this conversation, widen the conversation, and make policies and decisions that are going to be good for all Bahamians. Okay, we all want to be safe out there. And so nobody wants people to die. And if you don't want people to die, you should be open to early intervention, risk stratification, and treating people as soon as possible. Let's keep that's my whole thought. Let's keep people out of hospital. Let's give people alternatives. Let's try to create a better healthcare system for all Bahamians. If that is not the key, or if that is not the point of what we're trying to do, like, what are we trying to do? What are we trying to do? And so, you know, I give my service both publicly and privately. And, you know, I feel good when my patients are doing well. I do. And so I strive to do as much as I can to see that a reality in all things. And I hear what people are saying and what people are going through. And I think a part of medicine is being able to tap in to what people are experiencing. Be able to speak to people wherever level they are on and be able to, you know, converse with them, find out what's going on with them, and to help them to solve their problems. I consider medicine business. And so we need to be thinkers. We need to be critical thinkers. And we need to be ever advancing our knowledge. We cannot be stagnant, and we cannot be narrow in our view. That doesn't make a good scientist. And so hopefully, you know, we'll be a lot better. And so I want to thank everybody for listening in tonight. I hope it wasn't too controversial. You know, the truth is controversial these days. Data can be controversial these days if it doesn't follow a particular narrative. But I would rather the truth any day than a truth. I like the truth. So thank you all for listening. Stay safe out there, Bahamas. You know, wash your hands, wear your mask where you have to. And, you know, take care of yourselves. Take care of each other. And reach out to somebody who may, you know, be lonely, because we don't talk a lot about the mental health aspect of all of this. And there's a lot going on. And a lot of people need help in a lot of different ways. And so I think we need to stop all the divisiveness. I think we all need to come together to help to figure this out, what's going to be best for our country, and move forward from there. So be safe, Bahamas, brought to you by Medical Concierge Services. Check us out on Facebook, Instagram, and our website, mcsfamilymedicine.com. Give us a call, 326-1521. We're open to helping everybody. And have a good night. Thank you. See you all next week.